morning. Great to be Toho. I'll tell you what, this is a nice gym. And you got the football field under construction out there. It's good stuff. So I appreciate you hosting us. It's great to be back in Osceola County. And we have our superintendent is here, Mark Shanoff. We have Pastor Barry Rice with Go Church. Crispin Johnson, campus monitor at Toho High School and a parent here in Osceola County. We have Representative Bernie Jocks, who's going to talk about the bills, but also what he does outside of politics that is pertinent to these bills. And then we have Representatives McLean and Amnesty, and I want to thank them for their great support on all of this. We've worked really hard in Florida to support our students, and that's a wide variety of things that we do. We've done a lot, of course, to provide families with choice to be able to choose the best school for their kids and for kids to be able to be in the best environment possible for them. So you look at our charter programs, you know, we've got these charter schools that are public schools, but they're not entitled to any students. They've got to convince parents that they're doing a good job. And we have almost 400,000 students across the state in charter schools. We also have our scholarship program. We have almost 400,000 students on scholarships that are in different private schools. And then the vast majority of school districts in Florida have really robust choice options within the school district. So it used to be you grew up in a neighborhood, you went to that school, that was kind of it. Now parents are really empowered with a bunch of choices, and we think that that's important. You know, some schools offer some things that the kids need that maybe another school doesn't, and giving that choice I think is really, really important. Another thing that we've been able to do is really increase Florida's commitment to mental health in our schools. So starting in 2019, we have required schools to provide students in grades 6 through 12 at least 5 hours of mental health instruction every year. And thanks to the leadership of Florida's First Lady, we have ensured that mental health education involves personal resiliency, talks about perseverance, volunteerism, mentorship, problem solving, empathy, citizenship, honesty, a really comprehensive approach that is good for students, particularly when you're going through some of these years, which can be tough. I mean, you know, you talk about kids that are teenagers, there's a lot that goes on in that. And we want to make sure that we're doing what we can to help support that. So we have really good resiliency standards. We've also really supported concepts of civic and personal responsibility, because ultimately that helps when you're having to navigate different challenges in life. If you look at the mental health funding that we've done, we did $75 million in 2019-2020, which was the record at the time. This most recent 22-23, $140 million for mental health programs throughout the state of Florida. And in this year's budget, we secured $160 million for the FEFP for school district mental health assistant programs, as well as $5.5 million for evidence-based training to help school employees identify and understand the signs of mental health and substance abuse. So this more than doubles the annual educational mental health funding that is being received compared to when I took office back in 2019. So we're proud of that, and we understand it's important. Now, today, we're going to sign two bills that help enhance the student experience. It provides students with even more resources to be able to help them through difficult times, make the most of their own lives, realize all their opportunities and dreams. So the first bill is House Bill 1317. And what that does is it authorizes school districts to bring in patriotic organizations to come to their schools to encourage student participation and involvement. And these groups are as follows: Big Brothers, Big Sisters of America, Boy Scouts, Boys and Girls Club of America, Civil Air Patrol, Future Farmers of America, Girl Scouts, Little League Baseball, Marine Corps League, Navy SEAL Cadet Corps. And so our view is bringing them in, letting them come and make a pitch to students about why they should participate in Little League Baseball, why they should participate in Big Brothers Big Sisters, why they should participate in Future Farmers of America. We think that that's good. Not everyone knows what's all out there in the community. Sometimes it can be a little bit numbing. A lot of times it's just word of mouth that maybe someone tells someone's mom, hey, they have this, they have that, and then you kind of go. Well, now you're going to have these key groups be able to come in, talk about what they do, and ask the students to participate. And I really believe that when you are engaged in extracurricular activities, athletics, some of these other things, that's going to be a net positive for these students. And it's really important that kids remain active. We see this where you have these devices. You have people that are on computers a lot of times. We didn't have that when I was growing up. I mean, we had video games, but you got outside, you did things, you were engaged in activities. I think that that's much better. So this really helps that, and I think students are better off being involved in any of these activities than just going home and being on electronics for the rest of the day. So we're excited about this. I thank the legislature for doing that. Now, if an organization comes, because it's a free state, we're not saying you have to be a part of any of this. Districts have to notify parents when new organizations come, and they have the ability to give parents the option to withdraw consent from their child to participate. So you don't want your kid learning about Little League Baseball? They don't have to learn about Little League Baseball. That's up to you as the parent, and we think that that's the right way to do. So I'm excited to be able to sign this piece of legislation. I think it will make a positive impact, and I know it will benefit students who choose to participate. We're also signing House Bill 931. This establishes a statewide school chaplain program. Now, it's our view that if school districts want to bring in chaplains to offer voluntary services, that they're within their rights to do so. But there's been a lot of confusion about that, about what is permitted and what's not. So this legislation, it clarifies that, yes, school districts and charter schools have the authority to allow volunteer chaplains to be on campus to provide additional counseling and support to students. And, you got a lot of these problems that kids go through. That there's some students where, they need some soul craft, and that can make all the difference in the world. And so these chaplains will be able to come and provide services. Now, this is, again, similar to the other bill. Students can receive this support from chaplains if their parents provide written consent for them to do so. So if the parents aren't interested in that, then the students don't have to be involved in any means. Districts that have volunteer chaplains at their schools must have a list of all the chaplains on the district's website, including the chaplain's religious affiliations, and then parents can make judgments about whether any of those fit the needs that they think for their kids. But providing our students with more resources, I think, is better. And I think that this is going to go a long way. We had some districts who had been doing this. We had others that were worried about potential litigation. Listen, you have a right to come and offer these services. It's totally voluntary for a parent or a student to participate. No one's being forced to do anything. But to exclude religious groups from campus, that is discrimination. You're basically saying that God has no place. That's wrong. That's not what our founding fathers intended. So this is a good balance to be able to say, Toho High School is not a Presbyterian school or a Baptist. It doesn't have a religious affiliation. Like, we understand that. But if these students have the ability to get mentorship, to get counseling from faith leaders, that is something that they should have the right to pursue if that is what they want. And this bill ensures that. And I think it's going to make a positive impact on a lot of students throughout the state of Florida. Now, some have said that if you do a school chaplain program, that somehow you're going to have Satanists running around in all our schools. Please understand, we're not playing those games in Florida. That is not a religion. That is not qualifying to be able to participate in this. So we're going to be using common sense when it comes to this. So you don't have to worry about that. And I, to me, just as a Navy veteran, I mean, I really view the chaplain program in schools similar to how we have military chaplains. You would go and you'd have, and you know, you'd have different types of chaplains. I mean, you know, we had Jewish rabbis, we had Catholic priests, you know, we had evangelical pastors. We had a whole bunch of different options that people could do and pursue. Many people in the military didn't pursue. Many others did pursue, and that provides, I think, really useful resources for that. We also had these chaplains. I mean, you know, when I was in Iraq, they're out there on the front lines out there. You know, you got some of these priests, they're administering last rites to people who have been shot or been in an IED attack. And so a lot of them, you know, used very much heroism as well. So that's something that always stuck with me. But I think that model of just having this available as part of the services that you're providing, like we do in the military, we should be doing the same for our students here in school. And I think so what we're doing, I think the founding fathers would be thinking, yes, of course you should be doing that. I think that they would absolutely believe that this is an indispensable part of a good education. So we got to give students this option. We got to give parents this option. And it really goes with our whole mantra of let's empower parents and students to have a wide range of options when it comes to their education. So I'm excited about signing these bills. We're going to get to do it here in a minute. But first, we'll hear from the superintendent. Got a couple other speakers, and then we'll make it official. So where are you at? Come on.
Governor DeSantis and guests, welcome to Tehopa Kalaiga High School here in Osceola County. It's an honor that you have chosen our community for today's signing ceremony. We have a community of different backgrounds, languages, experiences, and education levels. But what unites us? It's our faith. Today's announcement is a transformative step towards ensuring success for our students. We have a standards-based curriculum that ensures our students receive the necessary knowledge and skills to be successful adults. But how do we ensure that our students receive the appropriate guardrails that allow them to codify a strong ethical code? In my 18 years as a teacher and a school-based principal, the most successful years were those when my schools had strong ties with our faith-based supports. This materialized primarily in the form of mentorship, advocacy, and parental empowerment. If not for the work of people like Pastor Josh Plant from the Church on the Drive, Pastor Jermaine Reynolds from Redeeming Light Church, we wouldn't have graduated students that went on to become electricians, engineers, enlisted soldiers, officers, and coaches. Their intervention and the mentorship and guidance provided by faith-based leaders and those that work in our communities in this room set countless students on a course for post-secondary success. The day-to-day results of faith-based involvement in schools and a student's ability to have various touch points through various activities, it's incredible. Increased achievement, attendance, reduction in disciplinary infractions, and again, additional touch points for every student who otherwise would not have had that connection in school. To lead in education, you have to have firm belief that every student has gifts and a path, and that faith-based supports can help actualize those gifts and ensure that that path is realized in many of our students. Since my arrival as superintendent in Osceola County, I have convened many community roundtables. The first, however, was my faith-based advisory council. The collective support of our faith-based leaders and schools moves the mission of our district forward and helps our students find meaning and motivation in their potential. Governor, Thank you for your leadership to ensure our students receive the supports they need to be successful, and for recognizing the role that spiritual guidance can have in enhancing the experience of our students.
Great. All right, good morning, everyone. I'm State Representative Bernie Jacques from Pinellas County. I see some friends here in the audience. And I want to start off by thanking you, Governor, for your support of these great bills, including House Bill 1317, which permits and authorizes patriotic organizations to come into our schools, organizations like Big Brothers Big Sisters, a great organization that you're familiar with, Governor, that allows youth to reach their full potential. And it's an organization that I've been involved with for over 10 years now, starting back when I was a young prosecutor, fresh out of law school. And I realized the trend early on about some of the people who were prosecuting, right? You can tell when you're looking at these files on your desk that they were coming from some of the toughest parts of town. They may have not had the best home situation, and they got caught up in negative influences. And now they're facing a prosecutor in a courtroom. And it was sad to see when this occurred, and I had a job to do, and as a law and order guy, I did that job well. But as I was doing that job, I often thought, you know, what if we could have prevented this from occurring in the first place? And I started just thinking about myself and that it could have been me. You know, I grew up, and when I was growing up, I did not live in the best parts of town. And I was faced with negative options as well. But the difference is I had very involved parents, including a very involved father who was very, very much instrumental in involving my education, knew all my teachers, got involved in the PTA, knew the principal. I mean, I couldn't get away with anything, Governor. I mean, it was kind of annoying. But the older I got, the more I realized that this was a blessing, and not every child had the same thing. And so I wanted to be involved, and that was my motivation for getting involved with Big Brothers Big Sisters, in order to be proactive on the front end as much as I was on the enforcement side of things. And so over 10 years now, the initial motivation was to make sure that a kid, if I could prevent one kid from ending up as a file on my desk as a prosecutor, I would count it as a win. And now, 10 years plus, I've now mentored two young men. My current little brother, we got matched when he was in fifth grade, and he's getting ready to graduate high school next month. And it just goes to show you that this program really matters. And the numbers speak for themselves. Of the youth that participate in Big Brothers Big Sisters, 90% say that their mentors help them make better decisions. 93% are being promoted to the next grade level, and 99% were not arrested and involved in the criminal justice system. And so while Big Brothers Big Sisters has great working relationships with a lot of the schools here in our state, this bill will help us double down our efforts to make sure to prevent these kids from going down the wrong path. It will make sure that these kids become productive members of our society and not end up as a file on a prosecutor's desk. Thank you, Governor.
Good morning. I'm Representative Stan McClain, House District 27. Governor, it's a great day in Florida when we can sign a bill that will enhance the opportunities and create a bill that will help our parents and students. And I want to thank you for doing that today. Also, I'd like to give a shout out to my Senate partner, Aaron Grawl. It was my privilege to be able to shepherd House Bill 931 through the Florida House. You know, we all know that our children are facing a lot of challenges, and certainly some of us grew up in a time when it was not this challenging, and we lived in Mayberry or wherever it was, and we know that our times have changed and things have become more difficult, and our children are faced with more and more challenges every day, and it only makes sense that we not only think about, we've done a lot of work in the Florida House, and Governor, under your leadership, in the world of education as it relates to intellectual ability for teachers to teach, students to learn. We've done a lot of that work. And we would sell our kids short if we don't meet their, also find a way to help make provision for their spiritual and emotional needs. Under the leadership of Governor DeSantis, members of the Florida legislature, we lead the nation by making a policy change that will give our parents and students another resource when facing the challenges of life. Thank you very much.
My name is Barry Rice. I'm the pastor of Go Church, and our church meets here on campus at Toho High School. Today is a very exciting day for our students, and I really want to thank Governor DeSantis and Principal R. Scott and Dr. Shanoff. Our opportunity to be here as a church in this school and in this community has really made an impact to the community. Since 1996, I personally have had the privilege of volunteering in the Osceola School System, Orange County School System, Seminole County School System, and Bradford County School Districts. At Go Church, we have the core value in which we operate that we are community engaged. And the other is that we're servant hearted. Our heart is for these kids. And today is a big day for our children, our youth. Many of us that are sitting in this room, we have made the decision to move to Florida because of the great school system. And today's bills is another step to prove that this is a great school system. It's a great state, and I'm very excited. But the beneficiaries of this opportunity is the children. Them having the opportunity to be influenced and in a character building way, for kids to be influenced and have the opportunity to go to a faith-based chaplain and other organizations that will be able to partner with the schools. We have been so honored to be able to coach on campus. We've been so honored to be able to serve at the concession stands. We've been so honored to be able to serve meals to the students during their activities like drama performances and ROTC performances. It takes not just teachers, not just educators, but it takes a whole community to build students of character. And we're just so honored to be a part of this day. We're so honored to be a part of this great school, and we're honored to be a part of seeing this bill come into action. Praise the name of Jesus. Thank you for your time.
Good morning, Governor DeSantis. Good morning, guests. My name is Crispin Johnson. I'm the campus monitor here at Tohopa Kalaga High School. I can't put into words how much I love my job, because being here, I get a chance to work with our staff, our administration. I get to work with our children every day. One of the greatest things is the fact that no day is the same. Every day is different. And not only are our kids going through things, not only are our kids going through things, but so are our staff. But I'm more than just a staff member, I'm also a parent. I have a graduating senior this year, and I have a middle school daughter that's in seventh grade. Recently, we had to deal with the death of my grandmother, and she lived with us for 15 years. She was a staple for our family. And it affected my children as students, and it affected me as a staff member. But I was blessed to have Principal R. Scott, Ms. Parker, Pastor Barry, Go Church, there to help me. And that's why I feel that this bill is going to be instrumental. Having a faith-based person on campus that can speak to the challenges that our staff have and the challenges that kids have and speak to them in a way that they can understand is going to be life-changing. Not only will it be life-changing for, again, for the staff, but for the children, and it's going to change the environment, the atmosphere that we have on campus. My family was encouraged by what this bill can achieve. The support this brings to the school can change the campus experience, and that experience can strengthen the community. Stronger communities means a stronger state. Thank you.
Well, we're excited about these two bills, and you know, I look through, you know, like the patriotic organizations. I mean, so many of them, you know, Little League, Big Brothers, Navy, all that, like, that's, I mean, I was, this has impacted me, both growing up and as an adult, and I think it's really good, and I'm also pleased that we're going to have a strong chaplain program in the state of Florida. It'll be providing resources for those families that want to access them right here at school, and that's something that's really, really significant. So as it used to be, I mean, when education in the United States first started, every school was a religious school. I mean, that was just part of it. The public schools were religious schools. You know, there's been things that have been done over the years that veered away from, I think, that original intent. But the reality is, I think what we're doing is really restoring the sense of purpose that our founding fathers wanted to see to education. So God bless the legislators who were involved with this. And so anyone who's going to participate in the bill signing, you can come up right now. We'll make it official. Have a lot of activities. I'm just looking. A lot more than when I was in school. So you've got cross country, volleyball, that had been standard. Swimming had been standard. You have bowling. You have men's and women's golf. Obviously football. You have, obviously, of course, men's and women's basketball. Weightlifting. Soccer's been pretty standard. Track and field standard. Flag football, in addition to regular football. Baseball, football, softball. Competitive cheerleading, fishing, you got a fishing team, man, beach volleyball, wow, so good on you. That's a lot of opportunities for students, and so it's great to see that that's being done. Okay, we have any questions? Yes, sir.
Governor, I got two, one on topic, one off. I'm curious if you'd go to court over this chaplain bill, because obviously the ACLU has some concerns about separation of church and state. We also heard that the Satanic Temple says that they are going to push to try and put a chaplain inside one of these schools.
Well, the question isn't whether we're going to go to court. I think they are going to go to court to try to do it. But just think about what the ACLU is saying. This bill, when the chaplains come to campus, the parents have to consent for the student to receive services from there. So it's purely voluntary. This is not imposing anything that anyone doesn't want. And so what the ACLU is basically saying is that it's okay to discriminate against religious organizations. They think the church should be a second-class citizen. They think you should not have the same access to come to campus that any other student organization or other types of groups would have, that it's an inferior status. The First Amendment was enacted to prevent that. First Amendment was enacted to be able to ensure that people weren't discriminated against on the basis of religion or on the basis of their faith. So I think it's a bogus challenge. I do not think it's going to go anywhere. And we're not going to deal with it. We will deal with it, but we're not going to entertain bogus arguments about that, especially when the legislature was very attentive to doing this in a way that literally, if this is something you don't want, then it doesn't affect you at all. You don't even have to worry about it. So they really went over above and beyond to be able to do that. So it's good, it's valid, and I think it'll make a difference for a lot of folks. I think the districts are going to have, so there'll be guidelines. This state, the state legislation authorizes it, but I think you may see a different approach in different school districts, and that's fine. So it's not necessarily we're going to demand that you do it one way, but what we are doing is clarifying this is authorized, this is something that you have a right to do, and of course within the guidelines that we did, but I think districts have flexibility in determining, you know, how they do it. It's also going to be just the fact that the chaplain program on a district by district basis is going to be a reflection of the underlying community. I mean, there's going to be probably more rabbis in, say, Palm Beach County than there may be in some other parts of the state. There'll be more maybe Baptist pastors in some parts of the state than in others. That's just the nature of it. And so I do think you'll see, but it's not going to be because government's putting the thumb on the scale. I think it's just because of the underlying, you know, we've got a diverse state. We've got 67 counties, and if you go to different parts of the state, it's different, all part of the same family. But I do think you're going to see, I think you'll see some differences across the districts. So I'm glad you asked that question. Don't weaponize these book challenges for a political agenda. We don't have time for the nonsense. We don't care about your performative efforts to try to make a name for yourself. That's not appropriate. So when you have some school administrators or teachers that are saying that somehow state law requires them to take classic books off the shelves, that is a lie. That is not true. That is depriving students of a valid education. Now, on the ones that the parents have had issues with and that would led to our transparency legislation, you know, there's no role for these pornographic materials in the schools. Why are we doing so well on math and reading that we can kind of adult? It's just not appropriate. So I think that 90% of the things, I mean, when they would say that somehow To Kill a Mockingbird couldn't be done, when that was on the state's summer reading list for the Florida Department of Education, don't tell me Florida law says you can't do that. When they said you couldn't do a book about Hank Aaron, when that was the book of the month for the Florida Department of Education, don't tell us you can do that. So stop the weaponization. And we had one teacher put it, of course, a video out, covered up every book in the classrooms. Oh, the state, you know, that's passive aggressive nonsense, and we're just not going to tolerate it. So we've not had problems. Most of education, we really shouldn't be having these problems. I don't understand why they're trying to jam in some of the materials. Here's a good test. If putting if I stood here with a photo from one of these books and you guys wouldn't be able to put it on your air, then it's probably not appropriate in a sixth grade classroom. I mean, that's probably where we go. All right. God bless everyone. Thank you so much. Yeah.